Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mage King by Timothy Ellis. Narrated by Noah Michael Levine. 1.
Who the hell are you? I just stepped out of my bedroom on Kelowon. Officially, I was living here in the palace, but I was actually sleeping in my own bed in my own spacious apartment on Haven Station. I'd put in a rift to join the two rooms across half the length of the Galactic Core as soon as I'd been informed the Mage King had to live in the palace. It was bad enough being the new Mage King at just 20 standard years old, without being forced to live somewhere as cold and forbidding as I found this palace to be. But given the sort of person the last Mage King had been, and the fact he'd tortured me almost to death several weeks before, my reaction was not surprising. The coronation had been a week ago, in the same room I'd been tortured in, and so far, I'd not been back in there. I'd made the concession to simply keep the peace with the advisory council, and truth to tell, it was the only big enough room for that sort of event. It had also been the first coronation where outlanders had been allowed to attend, in spite of objections, but there had never been any doubt in my mind that Bud, Git, Syrinx, Tanith, and Serena would be attending, as well as all of my Navy Mage 1 squadron mates. I still had a battle to fight there, but what people didn't know yet was that was just the start of my plans for opening up Kelowon to the rest of the galaxy.
How'd you get into the Mage King's quarters?
He went on when I didn't answer.
That's your king, said a voice behind him.
He turned to see who'd spoken, although he should have recognized the voice by now.
Who the hell are you?
I'm Sixer, and while I'm not surprised you don't recognize me with all the black removed, you should at least be able to recognize your king no matter what color he is.
Sixer was my AI co-pilot, the name being jointly chosen back when we were assigned AIs by the Imperium, meaning magic, in this case in a language called Somali. Git and her AI had done the same thing, only her AI was Uchawi, from Swahili. All four of us had chosen to avoid names from our two native languages. The man did a double take when he looked back at me, and I grinned at him.
Majesty?
Yes, Longdon. It's me.
What have you done?
The Karn matriarch in waiting and I decided to remove the curses which colored us, to see if we could. We did the magic last night, and the changes happened as we slept.
But your face?
What's wrong with my face? Sixer grinned at me from behind Longdon's back.
You mean, apart from the fact that it's not black anymore?
Whatever you meant, spit it out.
Well, yes?
Sixer was practically losing it.
You look like a Thorns Worlder, he blurted. One who's been beaten up and has bad bruises showing.
I was beaten up, and it's only now anyone can see how badly. One of the downsides of having void black skin, as the Imperator called it, was it showed nothing. If we bruised, it didn't show at all, just hurt. Our lighter-skinned cousin showed multicolored bruises to indicate how badly they were hurt, but the curse which turned all of us black and all of Git's people white overrode whatever color you should have been. Norden's people had been turned orange by the curse as well. The curse itself had been a bombshell only recently discovered, even though it had been in operation for 3,000 years without anyone guessing in three different societies. Git and I had been discussing it with Bud ever since, and while the Grandmaster Mage of the Imperium didn't need to give permission to try and remove it, and was out of his jurisdiction as far as Kelowon was concerned anyway, we'd both wanted his blessing to try. He'd given it, and also suggested how to do the magic. My bruising was still quite spectacular, even 2 weeks after the cause. My first look in a mirror upon waking had even amazed me, not just by the fact I now looked the same basic color as Bud did, but the bruises were still quite yellow, and one of my eyes still had what spine humans called a black eye. And technically, I went on, we are of Thorn's world descent. We should look like them, since there is nothing at all about our system or its sun which should produce such black skin color.
That's blasphemous!
I chuckled, and Sixer actually had a hand over his mouth now.
I'll be the judge of that.
Actually, the advisory council probably thought they would be, and that was yet another thing to be sorted out. However,
I'll be making a statement to the people after breakfast. Organize it, please.
I'll be going for my usual pre-breakfast run, then eating on Haven Station with my former team, and be back immediately after to tell people about the curse.
But,
no buts, Longdon. I don't need anyone's permission to address the people. and given the change removing the curse has made, I think people need to be told and shown immediately, and given the choice of if they want it removed as well. Don't you?
It's not your place to say.
Yes, I know. It's the advisory councils, and they're going to use the B word, which is why I'm not telling them anything beforehand, and neither are you. Got it? He spluttered, but nodded. Technically, he worked for them, not me. Although the previous Mage King had been the sort who demanded total allegiance from those who worked for him, and had by all accounts more or less ignored the council most of the time while letting them think otherwise. Not that it really mattered, given the majority of them had supported him anyway. No one had been more surprised than me to be appointed the heir to the Mage King when his son was confirmed dead, but as far as I'd been able to find out, they'd thought at the time my closeness with Grandmaster Bud and the Imperium they hadn't really wanted to join would be a benefit to Kellawan, and since few of the Masters had been able to do the sort of magic I'd demonstrated during the wars with the Trixone and Rottenuga, they'd had no real alternative choice. I had the distinct feeling over the last week they'd been rethinking that decision, but it was too late now. My predecessor had been removed by Bud for crimes against magic, Dick Burnside and myself, and by removed, I meant sent to a penal colony in the Gaia Galaxy, with his magic totally removed. So, like it or not, I was the most powerful mage on this planet now. The thing which bothered me the most was, I was probably going to have to prove that sometime soon, and I wasn't looking forward to it.
As you say, Majesty, I've got it. The preparations will be made.
He bowed and quickly left, scowling at Sixer.
One down, he said. Several billion to go.
2. Nice look, said Bud as he ran past us. I'd met Git at her apartment on Haven, and we'd mutually approved how we both looked. Ironically, our coloring was now reversed. The Karn sun was hotter than the Kellawan sun was, and so her new skin coloring was a bit darker than what might be called Thorn's World standard. We'd in effect reversed who looked darker. Not that it mattered. In meeting first, we were the last to join Bud on the morning run around the track on Hell's Donkey, Bud Station, now in orbit of Bud's world, the new capital of Thorn's cluster. So we'd chosen a spot in front of the running team, moved there, and waited for them. Bud knew what to expect and was prepared. The only member of our former squadron not there was Matunga, who tended to lap everyone when running on all fours. The rest were bunched up behind Bud and hadn't really paid any attention to who Bud had greeted so oddly. Jill was right behind Bud, and as she drew level and looked at both of us, she did a double take and lost her footing in sheer surprise. Mel and Norden did the same thing behind her. The entire squadron went down hard all over each other, ending up in a heap on the track, while Bud kept running off into the distance. Kit and I burst out laughing, and then lost it completely when Matunga suddenly appeared and found the track blocked and attempted to jump over the mass of people. He didn't quite make it, landing on Jill and going down himself. Just to add a level of ridiculousness to the whole thing, all their belt suits had gone into protection mode, making them look like leather-bound superheroes in a big heap. But in Jill's case, this probably saved her from serious injury from a much heavier cheetah landing on her. Rather than let Matunga's downing happen to anyone else, I moved all of us to an empty conference room. It still amazed me just how easily magic flowed for me these days. The Talisman of Tomorrow was a part of me now, and in theory, I had the same level of magic available to me as Bud did these days, just not the experience of using it at that level. I still had some things to work out in that regard. Suits shifted back into flight marine mode, which we used for running and training, and Git helped Jill up. I gave Norden a hand as well, and then we all helped the rest of the team up. Bud appeared a moment later, grinning madly, so he'd obviously watched the whole thing happen even while running away from it.
"What the hell have you done to yourselves?" asked Jill.
"Removed the curse which colored us," said Git. "We thought we'd try and see if we could. You like?"
"It'll take a bit of getting used to," said Lauren. "But the real question is, are you too happy with how you look now?"
"In principle," I said, "yes. But I wasn't expecting the bruising."
"I'm happy as well," said Git. "Although, as you said, it's going to take some getting used to."
Her hair had turned from white to blonde, which was more startling than one might think, and did have a big impact on how she looked.
"Are you going to be next?"
Bud asked Norden, still grinning. Norden looked surprised.
"Are you serious?"
he stammered. "Sure," I said. It seems the curse on all our people simply overrides the natural body color with the one everyone sees. There's nothing natural about it at all.
It's like the moment you're born, added Git. The curse adds a layer of paint to your body, paint which doesn't come off. It's why things like fingernails were colored as well, and when people lose a nail, the skin underneath is also colored.
But it's just a curse, said Bud. And now we know it can be removed. Your people need to know about it. He looked from Norton to Git to me. All your people.
I'm making a broadcast straight after breakfast, I said.
Me too, said Git.
Everyone looked at Norton. Don't look at me, he said. I'm a nobody at home. Hardly that, said Bud. You command the only Narangian militia forces worth calling military these days. Their actual fleet is so completely obsolete now, their admirals are more or less out of a job. I think you'll find your influence is on the rise.
Great. Just what I needed. He didn't sound enthusiastic, but then I wasn't all that enthusiastic about becoming king, and I knew Git was hoping a lot of years went past before she was called on to lead her people.
Grow a pair, Norton, said Wolf. Someone needs to tell your people and give them the choice of what they want to look like into the future, even if someone else has to do the magic.
That will be the hard part right there. We banned magic, after all. The revelation that our orange look isn't natural and was caused by magic, with more magic being the only way to change it, will be seen by many as just one too many insults.
That's not your problem, said Fina. You just need to announce it and let those who run your area of space do something with the news. What will you choose yourself? Asked Jill.
Norton looked troubled. I've no idea. On that note, said Bud, we have a few kilometers left to run, and two of us have all of them to do. He opened a rift to the running track and bounded through it. Wolf followed him, with Matunga after him and then accelerating away from both of them. The rest of us followed. I found it difficult to keep my mind on running, given my bruises were causing me pain, and I was doing an unprepared talk to my people shortly. I was so preoccupied, I missed the right-angle turn on the track and slammed into the wall. Fortunately, my suit shifted, so I avoided further damage to myself. No one saw, except maybe Bud or the station AIs, as I'd been left behind by all of them. Even 2 weeks after being severely beaten up, both physically and magically, my body still wasn't healed enough for normal running. Apparently, Burnside hadn't even started running again yet. With a sigh, I picked myself up and went directly to Bud's place on Haven, where we normally ate breakfast. I used the extra time waiting for the others to figure out what I was going to say to my people.
3. Kelowan, hear me.
It was the traditional start to an address by the Mage King, and while I didn't like it, I wasn't ready to start ignoring traditions. Yet. My broadcast was going live to everyone on the planet who was awake, as well as everyone off-planet also awake. The latter included mages working for the Imperium in some capacity, and civilian mages simply out in the Imperium making a living. There was magic involved in making sure everyone received it no matter where they were, with the comms rifts being utilized to reach the Imperium. Those asleep would be seeing a recording when they woke up. The magic went back to the first use of communication tech, but I'd tweaked it this time.
For those of you who don't recognize me, I'm Haynes, your Mage King. I stand before you now as our people should look, having removed a curse placed on our people 3,000 years ago as we left the planet now known as Thorn's World to come here. What you see is our true coloring for this system and sun for where I grew up.
I paused a moment.
Plus the bruising which resulted from the attack on me by our previous Mage King. Our medical people have never been able to determine the extent of bruising before. Some in the past even believed we didn't bruise when injured. Well, you can see the truth on my face now. The revelation about the curse which rendered our people a single color and the implication that our ancestors were considered practitioners of the dark arts of magic and thus should be cursed with looking black for all eternity was recent and has affected not only our people, but the peoples of Karn and Narangia. All of us have essentially been wearing a coat of paint over our true color. The matriarch-in-waiting of Karn and I did the magic to remove the curse from ourselves while we slept last night, and as you can see, it worked. The question you need to ask yourselves is, do you also want a not-black skin color? A survey will be coming to everyone, mage and non-mage, 14 years standard and older, asking your preferences. Those with children too young to speak for themselves will be asked to respond for them. The survey will return to my office and results posted as soon as collated. Yes, this is not normal. The Mage King makes decisions of this magnitude, and it has always been that way. But this is a decision affecting every single person on this planet at a personal level, and I'd rather know your preferences than impose upon you my own. You can see what I chose and the outcome, but I will not choose it for another. When we know how many wish to follow my example, the magic will be made available in an appropriate way for everyone who wants to use it. The matriarch-in-waiting of Karn is making a similar announcement to the people of Karn as I speak, and the same survey will be done there. The people of Naranja, not being magic users, will find out from the media what we are doing, and if they ask for the magic to remove being orange as I've removed being black, then it will be made available to them. For too long, Kelawan has remained insular, and even now, no outlander is allowed to set foot here without Mage King approval. That will change. It must change. We joined the Imperium, and as Imperium members, we've not been pulling our weight. Should we have joined is not the question. We did. Why we did is no longer relevant. Those of our mages who are out there in Imperium fleets and working to develop new magics with other mages from around the galaxy are doing valuable work. But Kelawan can do so much more. In some ways, we are still the insular people who got on the great ship to leave Thorn's world all those millennia ago. We have thrived here in this world. But until very recently, we never left it. We are surrounded by the Kira, who claim dominance over this area of space. We trade with nearby systems because they wish it. But we do not let them walk our ground. And we are diminished by not doing what others did. The people of Naranja and the Democratic Union left Thorn's world at the same time we did, with more or less the same populations. Neither had any magic, but they now span dozens of star systems and have populations which make ours look small. We must change. Some say we can defend our world without the Imperium. They are wrong. We can bottle ourselves up here for eternity and stagnate back into the primitive society we started out as, but short of that, we cannot keep the might of the tigers at bay for long by ourselves. Do we wish to be their vassals? I say no. That wasn't strictly true at the moment. I could keep them at bay on my own, but a future Mage King, or society without one, might not. The Imperium is our future. Do we walk through their societies colored black by some rogue mage who hated our ancestors? Or do we rise above that and walk as we truly are, as we truly should be, and take our place as protective members of the Imperium without being stared at all the time by those who don't understand why we look different from them? The choice is yours. But remember, we are human. And while our ancestors came from Thorn's world, their ancestors came from Earth, which spawned those who created the Imperium, and a lot more who joined later. You chose me as your Mage King because I have close ties with the Imperium's Grandmaster Mage, and I am the most powerful magic user now that the previous Mage King is no longer among us. As a demonstration of what I can do, a space station will appear in orbit above the palace tomorrow morning at this time. It will replace our few ground spaceports as the primary point of trade and will be linked with the other stations in the Imperium network. The time for Kelawan to become larger than we are, to walk the galactic stage as citizens of the Imperium as more than just unaware cursed mages is approaching. We are more than just a society run by mages. We are a people with much to offer the Imperium and perfectly placed a long way away to act as the regional hub for trade on this end of the core. There is so much we are missing out on, and there is so much we have to offer, which is unknown where it might be wanted. For right now, though, I stand before you as how we should look. You tell me if we remain a planet of people wearing black paint all our lives, or are we a people ready to embrace our true selves before the galaxy? Thank you for listening. I nodded to the cam, and the light showing it was on went off. Sixer came over to me with a drink in his hand, and I took it from him and swallowed half of it. Longden was looking like he'd swallowed a frog and then been hit over the head until he spat it out. Sixer was grinning, though, even though he'd be getting all the surveys and doing all the analysis work. Did you just throw the baby out with the bathwater?
4. I was surprised to see Dick Burnside at the morning's senior mage meeting. He wasn't a mage, even though he was the bearer of one of Callie's scepter shards, which he swapped with me for the Amulet of Truth. We both knew he got the better deal out of that. But although we'd found the Destiny Stone as well, and reassembled the Talisman of Tomorrow, which was Ganesha's artifact, and it gave me a lot more power to use with my magic, in some ways, it was more of a burden than a blessing. It did, however, let me do things like station creation magic without feeling it at all. I talked to Bud about doing it, and he'd been adamant I needed to create Kellawan's first station myself. And now I had, even if it wouldn't show up until tomorrow. The meeting was a regular one now, held on Hell's Donkey, Bud's station, now around his new home world. Git and Syrinx came in together, the latter still completely white, but they were obviously discussing Git's announcement to her people, which I'd already seen. Other senior mages and seers came in as well, most reacting to our new faces in a positive way, and it looked like everyone was wondering why Burnside was here. Tanith came in last. He'd obviously done the magic to remove the curse himself immediately after seeing my broadcast, and his skin color was almost the same as Bud's and mine. But he looked shattered.
"What happened to you, Tanith?" asked Syrinx.
He dropped into his seat before answering. "I don't recommend anyone just removing the color curse themselves without being asleep for it."
"Why?"
asked Bud.
"What happened?"
"Well, obviously it works, but it felt like I was being ripped apart and put back together again. It wasn't pleasant. In fact, I'm not sure if I have the proper word to describe it. Don't would be the best word I can come up with. How did you guys avoid it?"
Git laughed.
"We added intent to the magic to be asleep and not woken up by whatever transformation occurred."
"I wish I'd thought of that." "Everyone better let anyone with the ability to do the magic themselves know to not do what Tanith did," said Bud. "But to wait for a better solution."
"Such as?"
asked Syrinx.
"I was thinking of special rifts," Mai said. "Walking through the rift activates the magic, but nothing happens until the person is asleep. They wake up the next day with it complete."
"That should work," said Tanith. "I wish I'd thought of that, too. Someone had to try it," said Bud. "May as well have been you."
There were a lot of smiles to that, but Tanith wasn't impressed.
"Anyway," went on Bud, "Dick has something for us," he says.
"Dick?"
"I had an interesting day yesterday. I was moved back in time to 2020, where I met a mage from that time who said he knew Merlin."
"You what?"
asked Bud.
"Why would 13 send you back there?"
I thought it interesting that Bud wasn't questioning Dick's having gone back in time, just that 13 had been there. He was capable of time travel, we all knew that, as a higher being between us and someone like Callie or Ganesha.
"That's just it. I'm not at all sure it was 13. I am sure it wasn't Thorn."
"Why Thorn?" asked Serena, who was senior seer for the time being, given none of the other senior seers had wanted to attend these meetings, only a few of the masters.
"I was curious. I thought originally Bud sent me back, but Joe Vincent was adamant Merlin brought me there and put me back here just a few minutes after I left."
"Joe Vincent, the novelist?"
asked the voice of Aisha, the AI who ran the station.
"The same. Why do you ask?"
"There was a lot more to him than just being a prolific author. What isn't widely known is he funded most of the research and development which resulted in the explorer ships, the Earth stations, and the colony ships which left the system. No one quite knows how he did that. The interesting thing is most of his non-writing activity started after 2020.
"He was writing detective novels when I met him. In fact, apparently he told Merlin he wished he could talk to an actual space detective, and Merlin brought me back especially."
"That makes no sense at all," said Bud. "Especially for 13. From what I heard, back in that time zone, he actually hated humans."
"That's what I thought, too, which is why I showed Joe Thorne's face, in case Thorne was actually Merlin before we met him or something. But apparently not."
"Arthur named 13 as Merlin? Are you saying that wasn't true?"
"Who knows? I didn't meet him myself. But my point is, Merlin, whoever he was, wanted me to pass some things on to you, and made a point of not allowing me to know who he was or even looked like.
Things.
Such as?"
I wasn't sure Bud realized he'd just been sidetracked, but who this Merlin was didn't seem all that important to me. If he'd wanted us to know, he'd have turned up now himself.
And given the power Bud had used in recent times, it wasn't exactly like we needed another powerful mage right now. Average ones, yes.
Apparently, there was always magic on Earth, went on Burnside. And sometime in the past, like tens of thousands of years ago, Merlin lost it one day and restricted magic to people old enough to be wise enough to use it properly. Somewhere along the line, that became when they turned 70.
That can't be true, said Syrinx. We've never found any evidence that spine humans have any magic, and I did look after they joined the Imperium.
Well, that's the thing. Apparently, until the 1900s, very few with power lived long enough to manifest magic. Then, as lifespans increased, they started to. Those with magic formed underground communities and hid away from what rapidly became paranoid societies with agendas, where anyone with real magic would be taken away and put in a lab somewhere for study. They avoided that by staying secret, but they did it in plain sight, using what Joe called old folks' homes and retirement villages and complexes.
How many mages were there then? Asked Tanith.
I'm not sure, but there were large groups all over the planet. One of the tasks Joe had taken on was to ensure that magic users stayed hidden until now.
Now? Asked Bud, sounding surprised. He wasn't the only one.
Yep. When I told him we'd spread along the spine, oh, and by the way, he knew his world was ending already, and when, he suggested we'd find thousands of magic users on every planet we colonized.
Seriously? Why wouldn't we have found them by now? Asked Git.
My guess, went on Burnside, is they got so good at hiding that even magic users can't find them unless they're looking. And that was one of the messages. It's time for them to stop hiding now.
How would we start looking? Asked Tanith.
With the publisher of Joe Vincent's books, said Aisha. I think you'll find they're a front for magic users, since the same publisher has survived down the centuries intact, when most others fell by the wayside, merged, or were replaced.
What else were you told for us? Asked Bud.
That most of the mages were very low-powered, which also might account for why you never found any. Joe was the most powerful of the time, I gathered. The interesting thing was, they all manifested magic after they'd retired from a life spent working mundane jobs, and their magic manifested according to what those jobs were.
Examples?
A hairdresser who can shape and control hair just by touching it. She did women's beauty as well, and apparently looked 20 years younger than she actually was. Someone was able to balance the chemicals in swimming pools just by putting his finger in the water. They were using rifts extensively, although they called it door magic.
That dropped like a bomb on Bud and Syrinx, who shared stunned looks. As far as we knew, only Syrinx had retained the knowledge of rift magic after the timeline shift.
They had people who could summon, levitate, make Christmas trees appear and disappear, fix mechanical devices by touching them, and alter the internal dimensions of buildings. Whatever people did to make a living before retiring, their magic allowed them to do it better and easier after manifesting. Joe had even managed to get a few of them together to do group magic.
Wait, said Bud. Alter the internal dimensions of buildings?
You know what a TARDIS is?
No. Explain it to me.
But he couldn't keep a straight face. Courtesy of Jill, we all knew a TARDIS was bigger on the inside. I suspected Tanith and Syrinx knew it from the Imperator.
Apparently, he was an architect for his working life, but his magic allowed him to touch blank paper and a house, and a full set of plans appeared on the paper. He was then able to change the plans, and the house would change internally to match them. For example, he was making bedrooms bigger, and including bathrooms and walk-in robes as well. Also, larger living areas.
Bud leaned back, obviously thinking. We all waited for him.
That's an interesting concept, which could solve some problems with ship design.
Which ships?
Asked Git.
The ones supporting our scouting squadrons. I've been thinking along the lines of redesigning the Judge class again, as squadrons need a true carrier and a decent freight capacity. For now, we do one or the other on a ship because of space considerations. Judge carries no real freight, but four squadrons of jump fighters. If they had actual launch tubes, the number of fighters would have, and yet there'd still be no real freight capacity. If we could figure out how to reconfigure the internal space, we could get everything we needed inside the existing hull.
I wondered why he wasn't thinking a lot bigger than that, although most likely that was the problem the Joint Chiefs were currently thinking about,
and so his mind automatically went there. Something to ponder. Not Bud's mental processes, but what changing internal dimensions could allow across all the ships we had.
Why figure it out? Asked Tanith. Let's just find someone who can do it.
You think someone out there might be able to now? Asked Syrinx.
I don't see why not, said Bud, assuming any of this is true.
It's true, said Dick. As far as I could verify, anyway.
I saw a house which had 5 huge bedrooms with bathrooms and robes inside each, and yet pacing it on the outside revealed probably 3 times as much space inside as outside. I'm still able to tell when someone is telling me lies, too, and Joe wasn't.
Any seers back then? Asked Serena.
Yes, apparently. They were in the grip of a pandemic at the time, and Joe told me just brushing up against this lady before the world even knew about it gave them warning it was coming, enough that the magic communities lost very few people, while where the non-magical old-aged live were devastated in a lot of areas of the world.
What was Joe able to do? I asked.
It sounded like he could do almost anything he wanted to, although he usually didn't.
That was probably the whole point of what Merlin did with the age manifestation, said Celestine, who'd stayed silent through most of this. I sometimes forgot that Solidario had mages of its own.
The older you get, the less you feel the need to use magic unless really called on to. Even I feel that, and I'm nowhere near standard 70.
Bud was giving Dick a strange look, and he saw it.
If you're wondering if Joe carried a higher artifact, said Dick, I had a feeling he did. It wasn't anything I could put my finger on, but it felt like the shard I carry could tell when something like it was present.
Everyone looked at me. I shrugged. Burden. When people wanted the truth, they looked at the person with the amulet of truth. It was a burden I knew Burnside was glad to be rid of.
It feels true to me.
Could it have been Callie's scepter? Asked Bud.
Say it as a statement instead of a question.
Joe Vincent was the bearer of Callie's scepter.
The amulet of truth made it very clear to me.
He did indeed. Very definite, true response.
That explains a lot about him then, said Aisha. And it gives another approach to finding these people now.
How? Asked Tanith.
If we assume that what Joe set up during his life continued after he passed, then it should be possible to follow the money trail across time to whoever controls it now.
That's a big assumption, said Serena.
All the same, said Syrinx. It's a starting place, and if anyone can track these people, Jane and Aisha can.
5. The meeting went on for a while after Burnside left. Git and I had enough going on at the moment, so Tanith and Syrinx agreed to start looking for spine-human mages with the help of a group of AIs. The one thing we did agree on was that for every mage found, there was probably 3 or 4 people out there who would be mages when they turned 70, assuming they lived that long, and we probably needed to find them as well. Burnside left us with one last message from Merlin.
What was done can be undone.
And while it was needlessly cryptic, it did seem to be pointing us to what we already knew about the color curses on the Kelawan, Karn, and Naranja people, while also suggesting that the limitation for manifesting magic for spine humans to only when turning 70 could itself be removed. I wasn't sure it should be myself, but maybe if done selectively, it might not cause chaos. We had to find them first, though. He took himself off looking happy, and we discussed how to find previously unknown mages. The fact we wanted to wasn't even a question. The Imperium needed more mages, and having a source of more diverse magical skills could be very useful in training the mages we had. In some ways, I saw this as a failure of my own people to step up. While only a percentage of our population were mages, it was still millions of people, and this number was significantly more than the Imperium could use if only we weren't so insular and distrusting of others. The number of our mages off-planet was a decimal point in the scheme of things. Karn's mages were off-planet in much greater numbers than we were, even though they were as insular and distrusting as we were.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.